All right, so when we see the word fixed income, what comes to your mind? Okay, so someone said bonds. We know the basic characteristics. Basic characteristic is we pay some amount at time zero, and then for a few years we receive the coupon payments, right? We call that as maturity, and at maturity then we receive back the face value of this bond. Now, can you guess or think why do we use the word fixed income? Is it true that our incomes are fixed in this instrument? Yes? Or variable? Or fixed? Or are they assured? Assured, right? Let's think about this. Assured. Okay. So, which means you're saying if I buy a bond, no matter what, I am going to get that amount of payment which is promised to me. Yes? Which means even if company doesn't make profits, I will still get the payments. Yes? Even if company defaults, I will still get the payment. No, right? Clearly no. So the word fixed income means if everything goes well, then your income is fixed, which is not the case with equities. Correct? With equities, your amount of dividend could change. Even if things are nice, you never know in advance how much you're going to make. You'd get dividend, you'd get capital appreciation, but you're never sure. You're sure about fixed income, but we cannot use the word assured. Right? We know that it is always subject to default risk. Or alternate word could be credit risk. Correct? The risk that payments will not be made as per the schedule, or payments would be delayed, or payments will not be made at all. But in general, this is a structure. Now, do you think defaults really happen in bond market? Like, have they ever happened in India? No, right? Or yes? So, especially in the last 3-4 years, we've experienced a lot of cases. Not that we did not experience them before, prior to it, but recently some of the listed companies in India have defaulted on their bond payments. One of the very popular and big company that all of you know is Jindal Steel. So last year on September 2016, they defaulted on short-term payments towards their bonds. Then another company is another listed company called Amtek Auto. They defaulted, and the defaults keep on happening, and maybe we would see some more in the coming period. So default is always a risk when you are invested into bonds. But let's start discussing about what is the universe of securities we'll be studying under fixed income. From an issuer perspective, we will study something about sovereign bonds. Do you know what that means? Bonds issued by government. So government bonds, at times also called treasury bonds. Are they safe? Are they risk-free?
Yes.
That's what we'd like to believe. Correct? So textbook says risk-free, so we'd like to believe that it's risk-free. But if you think of it, there's nothing that exists in the world that's risk-free. Governments will tell us that we will not default. So please write that in the textbook. So authors wrote it in the textbook. But we know that many governments have defaulted in the past, right? So we're looking at what's happening to Venezuela and some of the other Latin American countries. US, since its inception, has not defaulted ever, and yet doesn't mean it will never happen. Correct? But that's one category of bonds that we look at. What else? Who else are the issuers of these bonds? How about, have you heard of quasi-government entities? Who are those? Also called government sponsored entities. Do you know any? So in the US we have GNMA or FNMA. Right? These are kind of sponsored by federal government, like the central government there, and then they provide some sort of a guarantee, not for all of them, but some of them, guarantee that we will repay in case if things go wrong. In India, the closest I can think of is maybe NABARD. Have you heard of NABARD? So that could be quasi-government entities, and a big chunk of American bond market is dominated by these players. Who else? Have you heard of non-sovereigns? What are non-sovereigns? Correct. Who said that? Excellent. So these are the bonds issued by municipal corporation, at times also called munis, or bonds issued by city councils, or bonds issued by states. The government below the main government. So the word that we use for them is non-sovereigns. Now, do we have a similar structure? So we know that in the US, this is a very popular structure. So many municipalities and city councils issue bonds. But do we have the same structure in India? Not allowed? Are they allowed? Mm-hmm. So you are saying Pune has issued bonds? Do you agree with him? Bol raha hai toh pata hi hoga. So even in India, municipal corporations can issue bonds as long as they find buyers. Of course, some of the healthy ones, Bangalore, Mumbai, Pune, Ahmedabad, these people have, I've heard Ahmedabad has issued those perpetual bonds. Okay, so city councils will or municipal corporations will issue bonds, a big market in the US, and some of them also have tax benefits, especially municipal corporations, but we'll dig deeper eventually. Then there are bonds also issued by supranational entities. What are those? So bonds issued by IMF or entities like World Bank. What else? Who else plays in this market? Who are the issuers? So we have corporate bonds. So from a corporate perspective, what do you think they'll prefer? A bank or a corporate bond or issuance of bonds? What will be cheaper? Bonds or banks or issuance of bonds? What do you think from the regulator perspective? For example, SEBI in India. Right? SEBI being the regulator, or let's say RBI, the central banker. What do you think central banker will prefer? Companies raising money through bond markets or through banks? Because see, if they are raising money through bond markets, then you and I are going to buy the bonds. Correct? So there is a risk. So who do you think regulator wants to buy bonds? Banks or us? Decide karlo. So here is what's happening in India, that we don't have a very strong bond market. Though of course it's showing signs now, things are definitely improving. So traditionally, corporates in India, when they needed debt funds, they've gone to banks. And it has helped the banks, right? The size of banks' book has increased dramatically. But when a bank is lending, and especially now so many public sector banks in India, there is a concentration of risk. Concentration of risk is if a company defaults, the bank goes down. But imagine instead of those bank, if you and I, all of us had purchased the bonds. If company defaults, all of us individually go down to a small extent. Correct? So there is a diversification of risk now. So from a regulator perspective, having a healthy bond market is always a good thing, because it kind of eases off the pressure on your banking system. And that's what the government wants. In fact, in this previous budget, there was a lot of discussion on how do you provide impetus to the corporate bond markets in India. And recently I've heard CFA Institute submitted a consultation paper to the government about what could be done to further improve the bond market. So in the US, corporate bond market is easily accessible to companies with decent liquidity, which is kind of a good thing for them. What else? We are missing out on a very important product. Excellent. Bonds issued by SPEs, which typically fall under the category of MBS, ABS, CMOs, CDOs, and many of them. MBS stands for, in fact, before that, SP stands for Special Purpose Entity. MBS, Mortgage Backed Security. ABS, Asset Backed Security. CMO, Collateralized Mortgage Obligations. CDO, Collateralized Debt Obligation. This is like ABCD of bond markets. Now it's new to you right now, but it'll come to you very naturally and easily 30 days from now. So what are these bonds? Do we have anyone from banking sector here? Okay, yeah, I have a couple of questions. So which bank are you working with? Federal Bank. So if I come to make a fixed deposit in your bank today, how much rate will I get? 7.25. So a fixed deposit on a bank will earn 7.25. And if I come to take a housing loan, how much will I be charged? 9.15. So can I not, instead making a fixed deposit, give a housing loan to someone? If I make a fixed deposit, I get 7.25, whereas you're charging 9.15 for a housing loan. So can I not invest and give housing loan to someone? Can I give a housing loan to someone? I don't want to take a housing loan. I want to give a housing loan. So I have a lot of, I don't, but I have a lot of money and I want to give a housing loan because I'm getting better yields there. I'm getting 9.15 plus, to me it's as safe as a fixed deposit. Something goes wrong, I'll kick out that guy and take his house. Correct? So it's pretty safe. I can always sell the house and recover my money. Can I give a housing loan? But I can using this securities. Right? That's the beauty of this product. So the way this product works is that banks will give housing loan to a lot of people and then they will sell those housing loans to in smaller pieces to you as an investor. So indirectly you're the one who's giving housing loan to these people with the channel of a bank or an institution called SPE. So how do you get paid off? Every time the person who's taking housing loan will pay principal and interest every month. Correct? EMIs. So bank will take a small fee out of it and pass on remaining amount to you. And it will keep on working. And of course, if that person defaults, then the bank will sell the house, you get a payoff. If the value of house is less, bank will not book losses. Who will book losses? You. See now the beauty of this. From an investor perspective, do I get a good investment option? Yes, because I get better yields. Even for a bank, it's beautiful. See now what your bank can do, sir. Well, what your bank can do is, you can offer your investors two options. You can say you invest in fixed deposit. Of course, it's safe, or at least that's what you tell them. Or you invest into this housing loan security. And we will offer you, let's say, 8.70%. Now, if investor chooses this option, he's taking a little more risk. And how he will be paid? Every time this person who's taking housing loan pays to the bank, bank will keep some money out of it for itself, that is bank's profit, and remaining amount would be passed on to these investors. So every month as an investor, I will receive some principal back, some interest back. Are you following this? These type of structures which dominate US bond market. And these structures had a very heavy part to play in 2008 crisis. So these are called mortgage-backed securities, asset-backed securities, CMO, collateralized mortgage obligation, and collateralized debt obligation. Are we okay with this? Okay. Are we covering everything else? Are we missing on anything? Some money market stuff then. So in money market, we have certificate of deposits issued by bank. Then we have interbank lending market or borrowing market. One bank lending or borrowing from other bank. Then we also have discussion on commercial papers. So we have discussion on some of the treasury market products. And of course, we have discussion on treasury bills. That's roughly the spectrum and few other things that we are looking at in fixed income. Do you want to ask any questions here? So this you need not write. It's already there in your juice notes. What I want you to do now is read learning outcome A very carefully. Okay, we'll start here and we will end on currencies. Alright, so I'm discussing these concepts and then I will answer your questions. These are different issuers. So we know that supranational bonds are issued by entities like World Bank or IMF. Now, why do they issue bonds? Because they need money. Why do they need money? To do the activities for which they were essentially created. Right? So we will be learning about World Bank or IMF more in depth in economics. And I think they are important entities for us to learn. they do have significant influence on how world economy, especially IMF today. Now, what you need to know with these guys, there's a curriculum example which says, how do supranational entities repay the bonds? How will supranational entities repay the bond? Because to repay the bond, you need to get some cash inflow, right? To make the payments. What do you think, sir? Yes. How do supranational entities repay the bonds? How do they make payment of interest and principal? So you're saying they take loan to give loan. Yeah, that's what you're saying, right? So you're saying they take loan so that they can give loan. Yes. So you're saying they grant loan to other countries, to which I'm replying, that means they take loan to give loan. Is it what you're saying? They take your money so that they can give loan to other people. That's right. That's what they do. So these entities give loans to multiple countries or at times even businesses. Like I have a fond memory of World Bank. I learned about World Bank when I was in school. So I grew up in a city called Aurangabad. And we have those world famous caves there. Ellora Caves. Have you heard of them? Yeah, very beautiful place. So I used to, my parents did an experiment. They thought, let's teach this kid history there. It didn't work. But they used to take me there on weekends. And that site had a lot of issues. Like it's an historical site, but it was not being maintained so well. So World Bank was funding for the restoration work. And that amount of loan used to be written clearly at the entrance. That the site has been funded by World Bank with this amount of loan. And I used to go quite frequently. And every time I used to go, I used to see that this amount is growing. Right? The numbers are increasing. And it kept on happening for years. Then I eventually figured out that World Bank works more like an NGO, less like a bank. So even though the word says bank, but they do a lot of social causes and a lot of stuff like that. We'll learn about them. So how do they repay? This is what you write in your juice notes. Repayment of bonds through receipt of interest and principal of loans made. So you can also draw this so that you kind of remember easier. This is bond investor. He gives money. They take the money and they give a loan to a, let us say, farmer. After some time, farmer will pay it back. They will pay you back. Of course, there is a lot of exaggeration here, but we need this concept for solving some of the theory questions. Repayment of bonds through receipt of interest principal of loans made. Are we okay with this? Then sovereigns are easier. We typically call them risk-free. Now, example is US T-bills. T stands for treasury bills or treasury bonds or so on. So you can write down here, they are backed by taxing power. Backed by taxing power. So we use the word full faith and credit of the government. Backed by taxing power as in if you're buying a bond issued by government of Greece. Then what you hope is that the country receives sufficient money through taxes. If the citizens there are willing to pay those taxes. And then they will use that money and pay back the bondholders. Of course, if the taxes are not sufficient, another option that's always available is if that, like for example, government of India issues bonds and they haven't received enough money in taxes. Another option available is print currency. It's your own country. It's your own printing press. No one stops you. You can print as, I'm not exaggerating. This is the reality today. We'll have a very interesting discussion when we go to currencies in economics. But no one can stop government from printing currencies. They can print as much as they want. The only force that can stop them is the economics force. That printing too much could be a little risky. We'll learn that part later on. But that's the beauty with sovereign bonds. Non-sovereign could be your cities. How do they repay? So they will repay by one, tax income and or specific project. So maybe a city is raising money so that they could build a particular stretch of highway or ring road around the city. And then they're going to charge some taxes on that. Like toll income. So then at times these bonds would be repaid from that particular income received. So either specific project revenue or the tax receipts. Quasi-government, another word that we use is agencies. The popular ones you need to know, GNMA, FNMA. We call them GINIMA, FENIMA, GNMA, FNMA. We'll learn about them when we go to asset-backed securities reading. Are we okay? And then of course, corporations.